Check. Awesome. How's everybody doing tonight? Good. A lot of you out there. Thanks for coming to the combo night here at Cal State. My name is Christopher Sven. I'm the director of the combos, also a guitar applied instructor here, as well as teach the improv course. You're going to hear a couple bands tonight, the first of which is sitting up here behind me. And we're going to be doing tunes throughout the course of kind of like jazz history. Some modern stuff, some old stuff. Everything's good, in my honest opinion. So how many people here have been to a jazz concert before? Nice. That's more than usual, actually. How many are here just because of a class? That's cool. That was me. I was there one time. So for those of you that this is your first jazz concert, I'll try to fill you in on a couple things so that you kind of get how everything works. It's a little bit different than most concerts. Usually, like a classical concert with multi movements, you refrain from clapping if they're playing like a work that has a few different movements. But for us, we kind of like when the audience gets engaged with what we're doing. So if you hear like a solo that you like, a tasty lick, please feel free to clap for these people up here behind me. They worked really hard, so that just makes it more fun to play. And we like some feedback from you guys. This first set that we're doing is kind of like a project that we did. Most of the time you get something called a lead sheet, and you just open up these books, which we call fake books. And they're called fake books because they're not really a very accurate description of the song that they're playing, but it's just kind of the nuts and bolts. And given that you've heard the song before, you know how to put the rest in place. But a lot of people learn from those, and there's a lot of kind of pitfalls that you can get into when you're starting out playing jazz. So what we did this time is we went to the actual recordings instead of using lead sheets, and we picked up the notes from the recordings, wrote them down together. It's kind of interesting because you all have a little bit different take on the same song, kind of hear things a little bit differently. But that's that was a neat kind of afterthought that we had. But they call that transcribing when you pick stuff up from the recording. And that's the most authentic way to learn this music. It wasn't really learned from books first. It was learned from people playing and listening to other players and then them adapting it to their instrument. So I could go on and on about transcribing, but let me introduce this band up here behind me. We've got he'll be up there next. On guitar, we have Connor Pennington. On the drum set back here, we have Jacob McBride. On the upright bass, we have Cody Cunningham. On the trumpet, we have Jocelyn Esparza. On the alto saxophone closest to me, we have Judith Nunez. And on the alto saxophone furthest away from me, we have Ulysses Reynoso. So this first tune here was actually a pop song. It was called A Taste of Honey. The Beatles did it. It was made really famous by Herb Alpert and the Tijuana Brass. Became like a Grammy winner back in the day. If you listen to it, it kind of sounds like a song that would have been off of Austin Powers or something. It doesn't really sound what you would think as jazz. But then an artist picked it up by the name of Paul Desmond, who was he wrote Take Five. How many people have heard Take Five before? Yeah, if you've heard jazz, you've probably heard Take Five. It's one of the, even if you don't know the name, you probably have heard that song before. But anyways, the alto saxophone player that composed that, he did a version of this song, and we transcribed that version off of his. It's one of my favorite recordings, one of the, like, kind of my gateway into jazz. The first time I heard this, and I heard Jim Hall playing jazz guitar on it, I was like, I want to do that. So this is the Paul Desmond version of A Taste of Honey.
Thank you.
So there was a taste of honey. Moving on, we're going to invite to the stage the wonderful Joseph Nava on piano. Yeah, give it up. He's a cello player by day and jazz pianist by night. So this welcome to the dark side, jazz. So this next tune we're going to do here is actually a version of the song. It was done by a famous piano player. This is Nobody Else But Me. And it was one of those kind of Broadway songs that was taken on by jazz artists and turned kind of as into a vehicle for like improvising. And now it's just what we would call like a jazz standard. But most of the songs started out in movies and like on Broadway and stuff like that. And then they took those songs and turned them into jazz pieces. This one has many different versions throughout the history of jazz. But we chose a more modern one by the pianist Brad Meldow, who's an amazing player. If you haven't heard him, check him out. Does all kinds of different things, mixes with all sorts of different instruments, plays with mandolin, does duos with like vocalists, but also has one of the most famous jazz piano trios of all time, the Brad Meldow Trio. So this one is from his first album. Well, it's actually his second album, but it's the first one by the title of The Art of the Trio, because he had a whole series of these. And it's kind of a bold statement, but to say The Art of the Trio, but they definitely had nailed it and raised the bar and kind of set what it is to be a piano trio in the 21st century. So I hope you like this one. One of the funny things we found with transcribing this one is Brad Meldow has a kind of a knack for separating both hands. His left hand plays the chords and that kind of holds down the groove, and that one's perfectly in time, but his right hand would float over the top of it, and it's almost like a vocalist, like kind of floating in and out of time, and while the left hand's perfectly in time. It doesn't sound that crazy, but when you actually think of how he's doing it, it's almost like he has two separate minds to pull that off. So this one was actually a tricky one for us transcribing it, because we all had very different kind of rhythmic interpretations of the song. So this is Brad Meldow's version of Nobody Else But Me. Thank you. All right, we're going to slow things down here a bit. This is a beautiful ballad, and it's a version of it that is probably the most famous version of the song. This is Chet Baker's version of I Fall in Love Too Easily. And Chet Baker's a good artist. Like, if you're interested in jazz, but you haven't really listened to it a whole lot, or you don't really know a lot about the music, but you want to kind of something to listen to, Chet Baker's a great artist to check out. He's a, kind of the perfect artist to kind of find your way through jazz via him. He was a trumpet player, but he also sang on a number of recordings. And as always, those became the more popular ones, even though his trumpet playing is phenomenal. But it seems that when jazz artists decide to sing, they become more noted for that. Off the top of my head, George Benson is kind of the same way. He was a jazz guitarist. But as soon as he started singing, he just kind of skyrocketed. So that's how it goes. I'm not bitter about it or anything. I don't know if you're getting it. I hope you like this tune. We again transcribed this one. It was pretty cool. Chet has a very, because he's a trumpet player, he's an instrumentalist and a vocalist, his idea of phrasing like a melody is pretty ingenious. So we learned a lot by picking up the notes from him and how it kind of differed from, we had a lead sheet of this one that we were looking at the same time. But he's a great artist, and you guys should check him out. So this is his version of I Fall in Love Too Easily. Thank you. That's a nice one. Yep. Sorry about that. Anyways, so we're going to close out the set here with a Latin jazz standard that has kind of become one of the most popular ones to be like taught to jazz students. I don't know why, but it has started as kind of a take on the opera Orfeo, and it was adapted by Brazilian composers. It was like a Brazilian take on it. So it's called Black Orpheus, and has many titles. It's called A Day in the Life of a Fool, Black Orpheus, part of my Portuguese, but Manhã de Carnaval. Yep. Sorry, I said pardon me. I'm sorry. It's not the perfect Portuguese accent there. But this one, this is, again, was from Paul Desmond. This is his version of the song. And this was one of those recordings that kind of was my gateway into jazz, and I found it really intriguing. A lot of times it's played from a real book and it's in a different key, so we learned this version off of the album. And you might ask why we do that, like, because jazz is about like creating. Like, why would you go and try to like steal somebody's licks off the album and play them? And that's kind of, it's something I deal with as a kind of a jazz teacher of college students. College students usually have this kind of like, I mean, I was the same way, but self-righteous kind of like, I'm gonna do it my way, like I'm an artist. And while that is a good kind of like attitude to have, a lot of times it's good to also respect the tradition and be authentic too. And I heard a quote from another jazz artist, and it was that all great jazz players went through three stages. The first one was imitation, and then assimilation, and then finally innovation. And I think it's really important that right from the gun, you don't start trying to innovate because you haven't really imitated and you haven't assimilated what you've imitated. So you're not gonna really be authentic. And it was pretty enlightening for me to kind of read that. And that's kind of been my approach teaching these students this way. And yeah, it is. The stuff you pick off of a recording, it's all like pure gold. And as much of that you can get into your playing, it's not stealing. That's what all the greats did. So as soon as you get over that kind of hurdle and get into that framework, you really start to succeed at jazz. So that's what we did. I hope you guys liked it. This, give it up one more time for this first combo here. We've got Joseph Nava on the piano. Give it up for Joseph. Connor Pennington on the guitar. Jacob McBride on the drum set. Cody Cunningham on the bass. Jocelyn Esparza on the trumpet. Judith Nunez on the alto saxophone. And Ulysses Reynoso on the alto saxophone. And before I forget, these the bass player here, Cody, and my drummer, Jacob, they are actually not students here. They're students of mine. I also teach at a couple other community colleges. Crafton Hills College is one of them, and that's where they're from. But they will be here next year, so if you guys stick around, come to another one of these concerts, you'll see them playing in this, and they will be a student at that time. So give it up for Jacob and Cody for helping us out. So here is the Paul Desmond version of the theme from Black Orpheus. Give it up one more time for the Tuesday night combo. So give us just a second here. We're going to turn the stage around a little bit and get some new artists up here. And sit tight. We're not going to do an intermission. It'll be real quick. Talk to you in a bit. All righty, we're ready to roll up here. Please welcome to the stage the Friday Combo. We're keeping Joseph on the piano there, so that's Joseph Nava on the piano once again. We got Sean Monsalve on the guitar, who's back after a brief hiatus. Welcome back. We got Mark Garcia on the flugelhorn and trumpet. And congas. You guys are in for a treat there. Yeah. Nate Wallace on the drum kit back there. He's doubling on the clams. We'll get into that later. Sorry. Dylan Ossa on the upright bass. So this first one here is a famous song called Like Someone in Love. And this one is covered by a lot of artists, like Bjork did it. There are a couple pop artists. And Bruno Major, who's not Bruno Mars. If you Google search Bruno Major, it tries to autocorrect you and turn it into Bruno Mars. But he's a different artist. He's from the UK. He's kind of like a lo-fi neo-soul singer-songwriter type of guy. But he does a cool version that one of my other schools I work at, they did that version of his song, of this song. But we did the iconic Art Blakey one, and this one is off an album also by the same title, Like Someone in Love. And it's a pretty cool one. It has nice interplay between the trumpet, who at the time was Lee Morgan. Art Blakey had a great kind of all-star band at all times. He had Benny Golson, who will be doing a chart by him later. And I said Lee Morgan. Horace Silver was piano player in his. I believe Cedar Walton did it at one point. But there was tons of great artists that just kind of passed through Art Blakey's band. But this is one of his kind of most iconic tunes, or his version of this tune. And I hope you like it. This is Like Someone in Love.
Thank you.
Yeah, give it up for Mark Garcia on the flugelhorn. And Sean Monsalve on the guitar. So now I'm going to ask Mark to put down his flugelhorn and walk over here to the congas. Sorry, I did. Yeah. But seriously, no. So this is a Benny Golson tune. Like I said, Benny Golson was in Art Blakey's group at one point. He wrote a lot of tunes. One of his most famous albums, Moanin', has the song Along Came Betty, which was written by Benny Golson, who's the saxophone player that wrote that. He's still alive, still around, playing at schools and playing concerts. Living legend. So I think you'll like this one. It's a really hard song to play. It's studied a lot in kind of institutions because it's so complex. It doesn't sound that crazy from an audience standpoint. It's a nice melody and cool sounding like harmony, but to actually play it and improvise over it is quite difficult. But hope you guys like this. This is kind of our combo's version of it. We rearranged this one, put the mambo behind it. Usually it's a swing feel, but hope you guys like it. This is Stablemates. All right, we're going to slow things down a bit here with a beautiful Duke Ellington ballad. This is one of my favorite tunes. So definitely a composition that I would say is way ahead of its time. It sounds like a modern piece that would have been written by an artist today. But if you listen to the original recording with Johnny Hodges playing alto saxophone, that was Duke Ellington's most famous saxophone player. I think you would really like this piece. That original recording is pretty fantastic. Once again, I'd like to give it up. On the last one, we had a guitar solo by Sean Monsalve. And a trumpet solo by Mark Garcia. And this next one's also going to feature those two. Hope you like this. This is Isfahan. Thank you. Beautiful, right? Love that one. Never gets old. So let's close the set out here. First, I'd like to thank you guys. You guys have been an awesome audience. Clapping, just like I told you. Yep, I'm very proud. sorry. Excuse myself. This next tune is a really popular one. Lots of bands do it. Kind of got a, like, became re-popular again within the last couple of years. But it's a really classic jazz composition by the jazz keyboard player Chick Corea, and it's his version of, or his take, not really a version of this song, but kind of he was inspired by the Concerto Aranjuez, which is a concerto written for orchestra and the classical guitar. And it has this kind of cadence in the song that is pretty atypical to music. And Chick was just kind of enthralled by that, and he wrote a whole piece around it. And that's what you're going to hear. That's called Spain. I think you guys will like it. It's a pretty high-energy song. Perfect one to close out the set. But first, I'd like to introduce the band one more time. So we have Joseph Nava on the keyboard. Sean Monsalva, he just took off the... no, I'm sorry. I don't know. He rolled up the sleeves, right? He did, yeah, that's what I noticed something looked different. Thought he was wearing a jacket, but I saw forearm, and I wasn't used to seeing forearm, so... Sorry. Sean Monsalve on the guitar. Mark Garcia on the, let's see, congas, the flugelhorn, and the trumpet. Yeah. Give it up for Mark. Got Nate Wallace back there on the drums. This next one's going to feature him. He also plays the clams. Why don't you hold the clams up for him? I think it's time they know. There we go. The clams. Give it up for the clams. And to my right here, we have the lovely Dylan Asa on the upright bass. Thank you once again. This is Chick Corea's Spain. Thank you. Thank you. Give it up one more time. Joseph Nava on the piano, Sean Monsalve on the guitar, Mark Garcia on the trumpet, Nate Wallace on the drum set, and Dylan Asa on the bass. Thank you, guys. Have a safe drive home.